So, today we're moving on to solution concentration. Last time we talked about solutions, what a solution is. Who remembers what a solution is? Composed of two things. What is it? The solute and the solvent. Correct. So we're still in chapter 11. Now, a solution is described by the ratio of solvent to solute. Think about it like this. If you are, let's say, making Kool-Aid, you can put a little bit of sugar in it, or you can put a ton of sugar in it, right? That ratio of solute to solvent makes a big difference in how it tastes. And so we use what's called concentration to measure that ratio of solvent to solute. So you notice, these two pictures have the exact same solvent, and they have the exact same solute. The only difference is this one's got a whole lot more solute dissolved in the same volume, whereas this one's got the same volume, but way less solute, right? So in other words, this one's more concentrated than this one. So if you've got your book, open it to 432. This is a very convenient reference table. Very convenient for the
table.
This chart will be given to you on your next exam, on the reference page. You just need to know how to use it. Page 432. So, percent by mass, percent by volume, mass volume percent, parts per million, and molarity. Chemists use molarity a lot. Alright, if you are planning on taking more chemistry classes, which I know many of you are, you will be using molarity in those future chemistry classes. Chemists love molarity. It is our unit of choice when it comes to concentration. So molarity is equal moles of solute over liters of solution. That was molarity. Parts per million and parts per billion are used in agriculture a lot. They're also used in environmental testing a lot, too. So for instance, if you say, what's the concentration of lead in a river? And it's 2.5 parts per billion. That's an example of a agricultural or environmental use of parts per million and parts per billion. We're gonna go over examples of that one as well. All right, mass volume percent is used a lot in medicine. So for instance, milligrams per deciliter. It's a unit you use for your blood glucose level. Your blood glucose level today is 85 milligrams per deciliter. That's an example of a mass volume percent. And then a lot of different fields use percent by mass and percent by volume. So we're gonna go through all of these together. You'll see several examples of each. This chart will be provided for you on your next exam. However, you need to know how to use it. All right, so let's start with molarity. We represent molarity with a capital M, and it's usually underlined. I won't count off points if you don't underline it, but it does have to be uppercase. Because if you note, lowercase m is something called molality, which is not the same thing as molarity. So uppercase M for molarity. Like I said, chemists, we use molarity for everything. All of the solutions that you have worked with this semester have had concentration in molarity. If you've ever noticed when you're getting something from one of the stock solutions, it's got like a little M beside it, 3.0 M, that M is telling you the concentration. So molarity is moles of solute divided by volume in liters. And so the units are moles over liters, moles/L. All right. We chemists love molarity. Next time you're getting something out of a bottle in lab, look at the units. Guarantee it's going to be capital M next to it. 0.5, capital M. 1.0, capital M. That's telling you that for every liter of that solution that you pour out, you've poured out one mole of the solute. So if I want exactly one mole of that solution, and one mole of that solute, and it's one molar, I just pull her out 1 liter. Now a little bit of warning today, we're gonna have to do a tiny bit of algebra, so if algebra is your like arch nemesis, you need to come up with a way to make peace. Go to talk to someone about your feelings. Do whatever you need to do, because we are going to use a little bit of algebra today. The dreaded A word, I know. Now here are the two most common errors. Notice that molarity is moles per liter. If I give you grams and I ask for molarity, what must you do? You gotta convert it to moles, right? So very common mistake is, if I say, you dissolve 100 grams in 500 milliliters, what is the molarity? Well, you can't do a molarity calculation with grams. You've got to convert grams to moles. And what if I tell you the volume in milliliters? You've got to convert milliliters to liters. There are 1,000 milliliters in a liter, so to convert milliliters to liters, all you do is divide by 1,000. These are the two most common mistakes I see students make with molarity. I'm telling you about this as a word to the wise so that you don't make the same mistakes that they have made. Alright, so for instance, if I want to make a solution of known concentration, you don't need to write this down, just listen. So let's say that I want to make a solution that has a molarity of 5 moles per liter, okay? So I calculate out what mass I need, and I go weigh it out, right? This is a 1 liter flask, so I figure out what mass I need. I get my funnel and I put it in there, and then I fill her up with water, right? This, what kind of solution would that be? Would that be an aqueous solution? Yeah, how do I know it's aqueous? Water is the solvent, right? So, let's do this one. We'll do it together. Calculate the molarity of a solution made by dissolving 5.00 grams of C6H12O6 in sufficient water to form exactly 100 milliliters of solution. How many sig figs am I going to have with my concentration?
Three.
Good. So first of all, what do I need to do? I've got to convert grams to moles. And what do I need to have in order to do that?
Molar mass.
Good old molar mass. So how am I going to get the molar mass of this? Mass of carbon times 6 plus mass of hydrogen times 12 plus mass of oxygen times 6, right? So if you've already forgotten everything you learned for exam 2, I'm going to have to relearn it. Like I said, everything builds. So, we're going to convert grams to moles. Why am I carrying out so many extra decimal places here? Right, we don't want to round after the first step, we want to round at the end. So, I converted my 5 grams to moles. Why is grams on bottom and not on top in my conversion factor? We want grams to go away. Right, grams cancel. So 5 times 1 divided by 180. Carry out extra decimal places. Now, if I take this number and divide by 100? No. Why not?
Because
it's in milliliters. I've got to convert milliliters to liters. So in other words, to convert milliliters to liters, it's 0.1. Decimal 3 to the left. And my final answer needs 3 significant figures. So your your units can be capital M, or you could have also written MOL/L.
Moles per liter, that works too.
So you have to divide by the
volume in liters. We convert milliliters to liters. Technically, those sink things would go with it.
Go back to that.
They have three sink figs in my number here. Those sink figs travel along with it. Everybody see how we did this? Okay, where'd you get lost? Converting milliliters to liters? Okay, there are 1,000 milliliters in 1 liter. So you just move in the decimal 3 to the left. Or divide by 1,000. It's the same thing. So if you take that number in milliliters and divide by 1,000, you get that. Because the problem says you've got 100 milliliters, but I've got to convert milliliters to liters. So I want to get rid of that little M. It's got to be in capital L liters.
Okay.
Good. And we round to the correct number of sink figs at the end. All right, you do this one. This one's going to involve a little bit of thinking. I'm telling you, you've got 15 milliliters of a 0.5 molar solution. So I've given you the volume. I've given you the molarity. I want to know how many grams are dissolved in there. Oh, crud. There's that A word again. Algebra is going to have to be used here. And in part B, if you've got a 0.5 molar solution and you need 0.038 moles, how many milliliters should you pour? Dreaded algebra word comes back into the picture again.
Thank you.
given you the volume, and I've given you the molarity, and I want to know how many grams. So what do I have to do first? First you have to solve for number of moles.
Right.
And then what do? Convert moles to grams. Okay, so can I plug in 15 as my volume here? What number do I need to plug in?
0.015.
Right. So 0.50 is equal to mole over 0.015. Right? Okay, how do I get number of moles? Gotta multiply both sides by 0.015. The algebra. So the number of moles is equal to 0.50 times 0.015. What'd you get?
0.075.
And that's moles. But the problem doesn't want number of moles, it wants grams. So how do I get grams? You gotta convert moles to grams, right? So when I write my conversion factor, does moles go on bottom or on top? One mole, Na2SO4. As a mass of, I came up with 142.04. All right, moles cancel. So how many grams does that leave me with? Now remember, round to the correct number of sig figs at this step. How many sig figs do I need? One or two?
Two.
Two. So how many grams do I have as my final answer? 1.1 or 1.2? 1.1. Okay. That's my final answer. Questions on how we did part A. Got to do some algebra. Algebraic manipulation. All right, in B, you're going to have to do some algebra again. Like I said, if you and algebra hate each other, need to go to like a couples therapy session or something so that we can get it worked out. You and algebra will be friends. Okay, this time I'm given molarity and I'm given moles and I want liters, right? So molarity is 0.5 is equal to moles, which is 0.038 over L. Correct? Alright, so we're going to have to solve for L. We're going to multiply both sides by L. So 0.50L is equal to 0.038. How do I get L by itself? Divide both sides by 0.5. L is equal to, what's 0.038 divided by 0.5?
0.076.
What?
0.076.
0.076?
Mm-hmm.
In agreement?
Yes.
And what are my units here? Now this is liters. My question asks for milliliters. Right. So there are 1,000 milliliters in a liter. So that is 76 milliliters. So you get out your graduated cylinder and you measure to the 20, to the 76 milliliter mark and you're done. So make sure that you understand I could give you molarity or moles or liters and ask you to solve for any one of those variables. Okay? It's not always just going to be to convert grams to moles and divide by the volume. I could ask you to solve for any one of those. Questions on A or B? Try this one. What is the concentration of the solution that forms when 2.5 grams of KCl, what's the name of KCl? Potassium chloride is dissolved in 500 milliliters of water. Is that going to make an aqueous solution? Yes, it is.
So at the end of our answer, we got like a little A cube, right?
No, you don't need the A cube. Your units are going to be molarity. If that's for concentration, you would use the concentration unit. Go by practicality. your answer comes out to be 0.003 liters. It's kind of hard to take a liter flask and fill it 0.003 full. It's much easier to get a 10 milliliter graduated cylinder and fill it with 3. There are going to be ones like this on the new homework that's going up on Wednesday. problem in one step?
No.
No, what do you need to solve for first? Moles, right? And then from that, what do you need to do?
Convert
moles to grams, good. So, number of moles is equal to molarity times volume. So I came up with 3 moles. But the problem doesn't want number of moles, the problem wants number of grams. So why does it round up to 310 and not 309? Only 2 sig figs, good. 310 with no decimal place. If you rounded your answer to 309, that would be incorrect. That has 3 sig figs. If you want an answer with 2 sig figs, you can round it up to 310. No decimal. And don't forget units. The problem asks for how many grams do you need, so make sure that your answer is in grams.
Why are you rounding all the way up to 10?
Because the closest number is 308. If you round down to 300, well, you only have 1 sig fig there, too, and it's way more of a rounding error to round down. If you want more practice on this, page 436 has some problems for you to try, and try the problems at the end of chapter 11. There are a lot of good problems worked out in your book. If you look at the problems that I've recommended, hopefully you've been doing that all semester long. But if you look at the syllabus and you look at the suggested problems, all of those go along with what we've been doing in lecture. All right, so we've already done molarity. Let's look at the other ones. Percent by mass. Alrighty, and the units of percent by mass, you write a percent sign, and then you write m/m. Because that tells the reader that it is percent by mass. So it is the mass of the solute divided by the total mass of the solution times 100. This way, we represent concentration as a percent. And you need this little m/m because that tells the reader if it's percent by mass or if it's percent by volume. Because those two are not the same thing.
It's almost like finding the percent u.
Not quite. It looks kind of like the formula for percent u, though. This is a representation of the concentration of the solution.
Yeah.
All right, you've got to add them together. And then divide by, and then multiply by 100. And then your units are percent, and actually I left it off because I was running out of room. You need to put percent M slash M. Okay, that tells the reader that it's percent by the mass.
Are you going to do crazy things like give us the percent by mass?
I could give you the percent by mass and ask for the mass of the solid.
You can.
That's just algebra. Pre-pharmacy.
the brave enough to share your answer?
9.6 grams of salt and 192 grams of water.
That's not like reasonable answers. Okay, so if the solution is 2.8%, that means that for every 100 grams of solution, you've got 2.8 grams of saline, right? So we can use that as a conversion factor, which is what it sounds like you guys did. If I want 200 grams of solution, because that's what the problem tells me, and I know that for every 100 grams of solution, I get 2.8 grams of saline. Okay, just take 2.8% and multiply by 200, and that gives you the mass of the salt. And how did you get the mass of the water? Right. You take 5.6 grams of the salt and subtract it out from the total mass that you need. So the total mass is 200, so 200 minus 5.6. That gives you the mass of the water. Good. So you have been. You got the hardest part. Because if we know that it's a 2.8% solution, that means for every 100 grams of solution that I have, only 2.8 grams of that solution are salt. So 2.8% times 200 gives me the mass of the salt, and then all I've got to do is subtract it from the total law of the total mass to get the mass of the water.
Could you have done it the other way, but like 2.8% equals grams over 200?
There's another couple of ways. Get rid of that. Otherwise, your answer will be off by a factor of 100. That's not good. That'd be one really salty solution. It was too salty. Or under salted. Which one you forgot?
This water of the universal salt.
We're a lot of these solutions. Yeah, they're all making us. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, and a lot of biology classes call water. You weigh up 5.6 grams of your salt, and you dissolve it in 194 grams of water. Okay, that was percent by mass. Here's its cousin, percent by volume. Guess what? It works the exact same way. Except now, every time we see the word mass, we're going to substitute the word volume. And so this is what happens when you've got a solution where one liquid is dissolved in another liquid. You go to the store and buy nail polish remover, for instance. You're buying water that has acetone dissolved in it. So percent by mass and percent by volume work the same way. divided by 190? What is it? 10 divided by 200, right? 5.0% slash.
Wouldn't it just be 5?
Yeah, you don't really have to worry about that. Well, yeah, that is a. There's a decimal. Let's assume that there's a decimal right there. There's a decimal right there. It would be 5.0. Yeah. Because there's not a decimal right there, it should be 5. To prepare a solution, we dissolve 205 milliliters of ethanol in enough water to give a total volume of 235 milliliters. What is the percent by volume of ethanol? That means that for every 100 milliliters, of the solution, only 3 of it is hydrogen peroxide. So when you buy that stuff in the store, what are you buying mostly? You're buying mostly water, yeah. You're only getting about 11 milliliters of actual hydrogen peroxide, yeah.
Shouldn't it just be 10 cyclics?
Yep. Would round down to 10, yeah, because that's 3 with 1 CP. Alright, moving on to the next one. This one is called parts per million, ppm. So this is the number of grams of solute in 10 to the 6th grams of solution. So it's the mass of the solute divided by the mass of the solution times a million. So if your calculator can't handle exponents, just multiply by a million. 1 with 6 zeros. You'll see this all the time in environmental readings. I know in Vincennes, once a year, the water department sends out a breakdown of all the different stuff in the water. It gives you the concentrations, and they're always in parts per million, parts per million. So that you can know what's in your water. It's never a violation, surprisingly. It'll tell you is like what the threshold is and then what their sample was. And then parts per million is calculated the exact same way as parts per million, except now we're multiplying by a billion instead of a million. So parts per billion is mass of the solute over mass of the solution times 10 to the 9th, as opposed to 10 to the 6th. Again, if you don't want to enter that exponent in your calculator, just multiply times a billion. 1 with 9 zeros. So ppm and ppb.
Just give me what we're using. Yeah.
Oh no, what we're using. In the lab, though, every concentration is going to be molarity. Right, it's mass of the solution, yeah. The exact table from page 435, is it?
432,
yeah. That exact table will be on the next exam. You just need to know how to use it. That exact chart. All right, so we use parts per million and parts per billion when we're talking about a very small concentration, right? If you're using a big concentration, then parts per million and parts per billion are not appropriate. Why? It'd be like 7 zillion parts per billion. That doesn't make sense, right? You're only going to use parts per billion if you've got a minute concentration. So for instance, if you work in a forensics lab and you're measuring whatever concentration in the blood, or you've got a hair sample and you're working in a drug lab, you want to figure out what's the concentration of cocaine in this person's hair. We're talking about very small concentrations. Yep. You're going to have way less than a mole. If you're working for the EPA, what's the concentration of lead in the water? Hopefully, it's a very, 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 very small number. I don't want to be drinking lead water. That's not good. So you're only going to use parts per million and parts per billion when your concentrations are tiny. When 1.2 grams of sodium chloride dissolves in 500,000 grams of water, what is the concentration of sodium chloride in parts per million? So, it's mass of the solute divided by mass of the solvent, or solution, times 10 to the 6th. So here we don't add. okay? Don't add them up. So 1.2 divided by 5,000, and then multiply that times a million. And we get our answer.
Thank you.
parts per million?
Yes.
No.
Not in the calculation, no. So I've got the mass of the cyanide. How am I going to get the mass of the water?
Convert
what?
Liters to milliliters,
right? Because if I have the volume in milliliters and I know the density, I can get the mass of the water. So first we've got to convert the volume of water in liters to volume of water in milliliters. My units of density must match my units of the water. So here's what I did. I converted grams per milliliter to liters. I took grams per liter. You could have done it the other way. It works out the same way. You're going to get 8,400 grams of water. Now you know the mass of the water, and you know the mass of the cyanide. Do you have everything you need? Yes. 2.1 ppm. Yeah.
So since it's like parts per million, you had to convert it to milliliters, or does that just mean like, I'm confused as to like how many, like what is the
actual? Okay, because the volume of water was given to me in liters. And the density was in grams per milliliter.
Yeah.
If I convert milliliters times liters, I'm going to get a nonsense answer.
I understand that. What I mean is like the actual, like the label of it, the parts per million. So
yeah,
that
that's my final unit.
But I'm like, how does that actually translate into real world? So is that like for every million liters of
oh,
water, there's 2.1?
Yeah, you wouldn't want to drink that water. I would definitely not drink that water. Yes?
So when will we use the...
If I asked for parts per million, the problem asked for concentration of parts per million, that's why we used 10 to 6. If I had asked for parts per million, I would have multiplied by 10 to 9.
Mm-hmm.
ways you could do this problem. This is the problem where there's not just one solution. There are multiple ways you could do this.
Very different is moles per kilogram.
principle, as in the leader of a school, versus it's against my morals and principles. One letter difference makes all the meaning. Clarity versus morality. You need that?
Good.